On October 18, 2020, speedrunning history was made. The Legend of Zelda was completed in under 28 minutes for the first time by Lack Attack.
Yeah!
This world record speedrun is nothing short of incredible. Let's break it down piece by piece and find out exactly how it was possible and what goes behind one of these runs. This is the Legend of Zelda World Record Speedrun Explained. Before we begin, there are a few things to address. First, the stream layout has a lot of important information. This is a replay of Lack's personal best, a 2804, the world record at the time, as a reference of how much ahead or behind he is. This is his total attempt counter. It was approximated because of a recent route change requiring a new set of splits, but it's in the correct ballpark. The splits are grouped by dungeon. These are the split times of his personal best for every upcoming split, which get replaced by the current run split time as he goes through them. To the left of it is the differential with his personal best. Finally, the third column is his best time ever to that particular point in the run. Being ahead of this time means that this is the best run ever to this point. In addition to the stream layout, there's going to be a few more things on screen to help understand the run better. A map of the current area with the route Lack is taking to the next objective in this corner. The current objective of whatever room he's in will be at the bottom, and counters for both total and consecutive enemies killed without getting hit will be at the top. The reason why this is useful will be made clear soon. The last thing to clear up is the category. The category is any percent no up A. Pressing both up and A on the second controller from the inventory screen brings up this menu, which normally appears on the game over. The continue option will bring Link back to the start of a dungeon, which can save roughly about 30 to 45 seconds over the course of the run. However, it's generally agreed upon by the Zelda speedrunning community that avoiding the use of the up A menu makes for an overall better speedrun, so this category is about 8 times more popular than regular any percent. Also, because this is the game over menu, it would be possible to abuse death to warp, so deaths are only tolerated if they don't save any time.
Alright, last run.
Well, that didn't quite look like natural movement, did it? This is called screen scrolling. By positioning Link exactly 5 pixels from the edge of the screen and pressing a perpendicular direction for a single frame, he can magically bypass the edge of the screen and wrap around to the other side, even through a solid wall. But why? The answer lies within the grid system. The main screen is divided into blocks of 16 by 16 pixels, just like most other NES games. This is a feature of the console itself. Due to color palette limitations, background tiles are almost always 16 by 16 pixels. Enemies move on the screen along this grid, so they stay aligned with the blocks at all times. Because a 16-pixel grid would be a little too constraining for the player, an 8-pixel grid is used for Link. For Link to be able to move along a given axis, he needs to be aligned with the grid along the other axis first. So, when he tries to move perpendicularly to his current alignment, he first walks to the nearest intersection, then turns and walks along his intended axis. Also, collisions with blocks and the edge of the screen are only calculated on these intersections. To make this grid system work, any movement that would cross over a grid intersection is automatically stopped on it instead. The way the game does this, however, is a bit unnecessarily convoluted and lends itself to be exploited. There's a variable ranging from negative 8 to positive 8 that keeps track of Link's offset to the 8-pixel grid. Link walks in increments of 1.5 pixels. This half-pixel, called the sub-pixel, is always rounded down, so for the grid's purposes, 1 and 1.5 are both equal to 1, and negative 1 and negative 0.5 are both rounded down to negative 1. Whichever way Link goes, if his offset reaches either end, he will be snapped back to the grid, and that intersection will become the new offset 0. The snap-to-grid function is only used when Link is at an end, not at 0, even though it's also an intersection. But when you think about it, because Link can only take up a few discrete points on the line, he doesn't need to be snapped to the grid again if he moves back and forth. This can change, however, when Link is knocked back. a damage knockback moves Link by 32 pixels. If he started here, for example, after moving by 32 pixels, he can end up at offset negative 0.5, which is treated as negative 1, misaligned with the grid. If he presses a perpendicular direction, he will first need to walk to the nearest intersection, in this case to the right. That moves him by 1.5 pixels to offset 1, which is again misaligned, but in the other direction. So on the next frame, he moves to the nearest intersection, this time to the left, and ends up where he started, back at negative 0.5. Link is stuck in an endless back and forth, never quite aligned with the grid. This bug most likely showed up in development because the programmers implemented a correction. When a perpendicular direction is pressed, if the nearest intersection that Link is about to move to is the one at offset 0, the grid offset is shifted by 8 so that he would now be moving towards an end, allowing the snap to the intersection to happen. This corrected the knockback issue, but introduced a screen scroll glitch. By positioning Link exactly here, at offset 3.0, and pressing a perpendicular direction for exactly one frame, this sequence of events happens. Link is misaligned with the vertical grid, so he needs to move to the nearest intersection, which is to the left. However, that intersection is at offset 0, so to make sure that he's snapped to it correctly, the grid offset is shifted 8 pixels to the right until Link reaches the intersection. Now, Link is at offset negative 5 and he moves to the left by 1.5 pixels, moving to negative 6.5. Note that if he moves for a second frame, he will end up at the intersection and everything will behave as normal, which is why it's crucial that the direction is pressed for one single frame. When Link stops at offset negative 6.5, he is now at an irregular offset position and offset 0 is now at the edge of the screen. Link then moves to the right, stopping at positions negative 0.5 and 1, skipping over 0 and 0.5. So he bypasses the grid intersection, which in turn bypasses the collision detection with the edge of the screen. This causes Link's horizontal position to overflow past 255 and back to 0, and so he wraps around and pops out on the other side of the screen. Note that Link's position is on this corner of his sprite. Therefore, the collision detection with the far left wall fails because at this point, the wall is at 0 and Link is at 248, nowhere near the wall. Remember, this is pixel perfect and a single frame button press every time Lack does this trick. While it can allow Link to scroll the screen from inside walls and take major shortcuts, it's also often used just to save a couple of seconds of walking. You may wonder why Lack took so long to enter the dungeon. This was no mistake. It turns out he was manipulating the dungeon's random enemy patterns by loading it on a specific frame. You may be familiar with this concept from the NES Mario games. Well, The Legend of Zelda works the same way. The game's random number generation function produces a new number on every frame, and it goes through a long sequence that takes about 9 minutes to start repeating. But the trick is, when powering on the console, the sequence always starts at exactly the same point every time. So after a fixed number of frames, the random number will always be the same between every reset. Because enemy behavior makes heavy use of this random function, entering a screen on the correct frame can set their pattern to a favorable one. Note that because of another mechanic that we'll get to later, there are still two possible enemy patterns on any given frame. There's just one tiny problem though. The game runs at 60 frames per second. Can Lack Attack really enter the dungeon frame perfectly? Well, the answer is no. He can't reliably do that. But thankfully, he doesn't need to because of frame rules. A frame rule is a pattern that repeats itself on a fixed cycle of some length greater than one frame. Again, this concept is very important in Super Mario Bros., but it exists here as well. This time, the frame rule is tied to the animation when entering or exiting one of these caves, which makes use of every fourth frame on a global timer that runs from power on. This means that whenever Link enters or exits a cave like this dungeon and this animation plays, the game will always be aligned on a 4-frame rule. This effectively reduces the possible outcomes when entering the dungeon from 60 per second to a much more manageable 15 per second. To help time it right, Lack uses the music as an audio cue. So for a minor time investment, this manipulation makes the first dungeon much more reliable, on top of saving upwards of 10 seconds compared to what would otherwise be considered a good enemy pattern. Here's the layout of level 3. Like any other dungeon, level 3 has a key item and a Triforce piece. Typically, the goal in every dungeon will be to collect the key item, then defeat the boss and acquire the Triforce piece. In this case, the key item is a raft, which allows Link to cross bodies of water, opening up some parts of the overworld. In red are rooms where Lack will need to kill every enemy to progress or to be rewarded with something. The blue rooms are where he will need to open up a wall with a bomb, and green rooms have a key he can pick up. Lack will be taking this route to the raft, then he'll make his way to the boss. Keep an eye on the map to follow along with this route.
Yeah, that can happen.
Here are most of the enemies in The Legend of Zelda. They all have unique behaviors and stats, but they share this common property of being somewhat harmless in this speedrun. They usually damage Link through contact, and sometimes a simple attack. The blue ones are stronger than their red counterparts, having more health and dealing more damage. More complex enemies will be properly introduced as they are encountered, so if any enemy isn't specifically talked about, it's a relatively minor threat.
Alright, here we go.
This is a Dark Nut. Its main feature is its shield, which blocks all incoming damage from the front. This makes Dark Nuts especially challenging to kill, although they can be damaged by bombs. When a bomb is placed, it inherits Link's facing angle. The bomb then retains that angle no matter if Link turns after it's placed. If that angle is facing the Dark Nut's shield when the bomb explodes, the Dark Nut will block the damage. So, killing these enemies requires strategy when placing the bombs and a bit of luck with their movement pattern. This hit was intentional. Remember that the enemies on any given screen used a random function to set their behavior. This means that entering the dungeon at a specific time is only the first step of the enemy manipulation. He also needs to play the dungeon at a metronomic pace, entering every new screen on exactly the right frame. Taking a hit there is part of this setup, as it is much more consistent to keep holding left than it is to change directions twice. Lack carries this perfect pace all the way to getting the raft, at which point he will start playing normally and encountering random patterns.
All good.
This is a bubble. Although bubbles don't deal any damage to Link, when hit by them, Link will still recoil and have invincibility frames, which is both a blessing and a curse, literally. The curse prevents him from using his sword for about 2.5 seconds, which can considerably slow down rooms where other enemies have to be killed to progress.
It's 4 frames.
How did Link walk through the Dark Nut without getting hit? Well, because the Dark Nut was taking damage. During their invincibility frames, enemies also can't damage Link by contact. But typically, enemies also get knocked back when hit, which prevents walking through them. However, because enemies can only move along the 16-pixel grid, if they're misaligned with the grid and hit perpendicularly to their current movement axis, they don't get knocked back and can be walked through.
It's 4 frames. 4 frame, because there is a frame rule when entering level 3, or any level. So the level only loads every 4 frames. Yeah. You gotta be in that 4-frame window to get any single pattern. But you can get there's two sets of patterns you can get.
This is Manhandla, a fire-spitting, four-headed, carnivorous plant. Every time one of its heads is killed, it starts moving faster. This boss can be quite challenging when fighting it with the sword, but a perfectly placed bomb can kill all 4 heads at once and make quick work of this fight. You may wonder what happened to the counters at the top. Manhandla's core is supposed to be invulnerable, but it can, in fact, be damaged by bombs. It's actually vulnerable, but invincible. On every frame, it's forced back to life if it took damage. During the bomb explosion, the core is killed and brought back to life on every frame, causing the consecutive counters to increment very quickly. The same thing will be done again later on Gleok's detached head. This sound is also the kill sound, but played on every frame.
Patience. Gotta have the patience.
At the end of each dungeon, Link's health is replenished. This is very useful, but it does take time, 43 frames per heart. It's not a big deal in this case, but in some extreme cases, it can take up to 8 precious seconds to refill his health. Next, Lack is headed to level 4, which can only be accessed using the raft that he just got.
Yeah, it's like there's a bus. Imagine there's a bus. No, I don't. There is a manipulation for level 4. But I do not do it.
Here's the layout of level 4. In the purple rooms, Lack will need to kill every enemy, then push a specific block to open the door or to reveal a secret staircase. The key item in this dungeon is the ladder, which allows Link to cross one tile wide water obstacles. On top of being required to beat this dungeon, having the ladder speeds up rooms with water obstacles, including a couple of rooms in level 1. After getting the ladder, Lack will make his way to the boss using a shortcut through bombable walls, but taking a small detour to pick up a key for later. This is not immediately obvious because the room is dark, but Link actually went through the block. But how could he do that? Well, it's simple. It works exactly the same way as screen scrolling. By lining up at the right spot and pressing perpendicular, Link misaligns himself with the grid in such a way that he bypasses the collision detection with the block. Note that Lack used the sword here. Doing this actually makes the trick easier. While slashing his sword, Link is prevented from moving, which has two benefits. 1. The trick actually works from two positions instead of one, and 2. The press doesn't have to be a single frame as long as it's contained within the sword slash. The reason this can't be used for a screen scroll is because Link can't use his sword while he's near the edge of the screen, possibly to prevent weapons from wrapping around to the other side, although it can still happen. Block clips will be used in many similar rooms throughout the game to bypass the need to kill every enemy in the room, then push a block to open the way to the staircase.
Machu Picchu.
Here, Lack is lucky enough to get a bomb drop. Or is he? Nope, there was no luck here. In Zelda, enemy drops are not as random as they seem. Enemies are split in 5 groups, all of which have different item drops and probabilities. At any given point, an enemy can only give a single item. Which item it is depends on how many enemies have been killed so far. For example, a red dark nut from Group B has a 41% chance of dropping an item, and depending on the kill count, that item will be a rupee, a heart, a bomb, or a clock. So by memorizing this table and by counting enemies killed from the beginning of the game, Lack can plan ahead to maximize his chances of getting bomb drops and other useful items.
Hey, that was a bomb!
On top of that, every 10th enemy killed is guaranteed to drop a blue rupee. If that 10th enemy is killed with a bomb, the drop will be 4 bombs instead. The game actually tells the player about this, although some deduction is in order. Bombs are a crucial resource in this run, given that Lack's only other weapon for most of the run is the wooden sword. Throughout the run, Lack will be saying his enemy count out loud every now and then. He needs to keep track of it at all times and plan out which enemy he wishes to be his 10th kill so he can get a guaranteed bomb drop. He does sometimes want to get a rupee drop, but usually he goes for bombs. Also, there's another separate count going on at the same time, but this one counts to 16. Any item-dropping enemy will drop a fairy if the counter is at 16. From now on, these three counters will be called the global enemy counter, the bomb counter, and the fairy counter. Of course, there are caveats. First, the forced drops require consecutive kills without taking damage or being knocked back at all. This means that every time Link is hit, both the bomb counter and the fairy counter are reset to zero. If the 10th enemy killed cannot drop an item, the rupee or bomb will be stored until the next enemy that drops an item is killed. However, if the 16th enemy doesn't give an item, then the fairy drop will be skipped entirely. Finally, the bomb counter is reset every time any guaranteed drop happens, even if it was delayed, but the fairy counter isn't. So, after Link is hit, fairies can be forced only once after 16 enemies, not every 16 enemies. This also means that a fairy drop resets the bomb counter, so after the 10th enemy bomb drop, one would have to wait until the 26th to get another one. Unless, with clever routing, the fairy drop is skipped. That also skips the bomb counter reset and a bomb can be acquired on a 20th enemy instead. Long story short, many rules to remember, many strategies possible, and multiple counters to keep track of. The counters are at the top of the screen if you want to keep track of them.
It's always nice. Yeah, I kill the gels to add to the count. I want to force a 5 rupee in this NSC room the first time through. So I need at least 4. People always look at you weird, that's their fault.
This is Gleok, a two-headed dragon. The heads take 10 and 6 swords hits respectively, and when a head is killed, it flies around the room trying to hit Link, so this can be a tricky boss fight. You may have noticed that Link lost the ability to fire beams with his sword. The beam sword is an ability that is automatically available when, and only when, Link is at full health. When he takes damage, this not only resets the bomb counter, but it also takes away the beam sword ability. The beam sword speeds up many rooms, sometimes significantly, so whenever possible, Lack tries to keep his health full to make use of it. Next, Lack goes to level 1 using a straightforward route.
Yes, one pirouette. I'm paying attention. I am locked in.
Here's the layout of level 1. The bow can be found in this corner. This weapon is used to defeat certain bosses, including Ganon, so it can't be skipped. Afterwards, the route to the boss is linear. As you can see, the ladder from level 4 will speed up these two rooms. But hold on, what was that about a pirouette? Well, look at this door.
Here we go. One, only one.
It's magically open now. How is that possible? The answer has to do with how the game manages room transitions in dungeons. When you think about it, if Link goes through a door in one room, that same door needs to be open on the other side. So whenever Link enters one of the 4 doorways in a room, the door on the opposite side of the next room where Link will be coming out from is automatically opened. In the case of a shutter door, it will close behind Link afterwards. In this case, when Link enters the bottom doorway, the game remembers to open the top door in the next room. Here, however, the doorway leads back to the overworld through the dungeon stairs, which isn't the same as a screen transition. So the door interaction doesn't take place and its state is preserved. When Link re-enters the dungeon, the top door is opened, saving one key. Note that this is the only place in the game where this can be done, because nearly every other first room of a dungeon has no locked doors.
One, only one. I did do two earlier, and then kept the run going. Turned out okay. Should be 10.
Here, the Stalfos is holding a key. Normally, you would have to kill it to obtain the key, but with a well-timed strike, Link can walk through it and grab the key on the way, saving time. You may also have noticed that Link keeps moving during the sword animation. This is because of the way the ladder allows Link to walk on water. Collision works by setting Link's movement angle to zero, essentially preventing him to move. The ladder restores that angle to allow him to walk anyway. Now, using an item like the sword also roots Link in place by setting his movement angle to zero during the animation. As a result, the ladder also overrides that, and Link can move while slashing his sword when the ladder is deployed. But there's another layer to this. Usually, when Link reaches the center of the ladder, it stops overriding normal collision checks to ensure that he doesn't walk further than he should. So the sword slash stops Link at the intersection until the end of the animation. But if Link is moving up, he can keep going anyway. Why? The reason has to do with the 3D effect. To achieve this effect, even though Link's sprite is 16 by 16 pixels, his collision box is only in the lower half of his body. This allows him to partially overlap walls so long as his feet are on the ground, but it posed a problem for the ladder. To ensure that Link doesn't walk too far out, the ladder explicitly checks for collision 8 pixels further up than Link would onto the next tile. If the tile is non-solid, the ladder overrides Link's movement angle again to allow him to move. So while Link can move during a sword slash on the ladder in any direction, he'll keep going past the center of the ladder if and only if he's moving upwards.
Perfect one pirouette.
Link slashes his sword while picking up the bow here because Lack pressed A at the exact same time that he touched the bow. This trick, called the crotch sword for obvious reasons, is a frame perfect button press.
Alright. I think most people watching are cheering for me to PB. I would hope that everybody is, but you never know. Let's see. Counts 5? 0 now.
This is Aquamentus. It's a fairly easy boss, taking only 6 hits or 1 bomb and 2 sword hits, so Lack makes quick work of it.
Beautiful.
Now that Lack has beaten level 1, he goes to level 2 next. He does take a detour to a secret cave for a bonus heart container. This route picks up the magical sword later on, which requires 12 hearts to wield and quadruples Link's sword damage. So, heart containers are not only a safety measure, but also help drastically speed up the last few dungeons.
This pace means nothing. Just put your excitement down until you get through 2 and get through 5. Then you can get excited. After you get the recorder with 2 bombs, you can get excited. This is just part of the cutscene to get to the part that matters.
Here's the layout of level 2. The key item of level 2, the magical boomerang, is not required to beat the game, so it's skipped. Lack instead goes straight for the boss, only slowing down to collect 3 keys by clearing some rooms.
Yeah, when it's over 1%. That'd be the day. Okay. Not expecting that pattern.
These are mold worms, two worms with 5 segments that need to be killed individually. Thankfully, bombs are amazing against them, and Lack dispatches them pretty much instantly.
It's actually okay.
This is Dodongo. This dinosaur eats bombs for breakfast, but it hates smoke. To kill it, Lack needs to neutralize it with a bomb explosion. So he needs to place the bomb such that Dodongo doesn't get a chance to eat it before it explodes, yet close enough so that the smoke neutralizes Dodongo. After that, a simple sword slash does the job.
Oh my goodness, I can't believe that that worked. How nervous I was when I saw I had 5 bombs.
Next, Lack goes to level 5. But first, he takes a quick trip to the secret cave to get a bonus 100 rupees. Later in this run, Lack needs to spend a total of 142 rupees, 60 to buy the food, an item used to get past a hungry gorilla at level 7, and 80 to buy arrows for his bow. What about the last 2 rupees? While there is a separate ammo count for bombs, there isn't one for arrows. Instead, arrows are shared with rupees, one arrow costing 1 rupee. The bow needs to be used a bare minimum of 2 times during the run, but additional rupees might come in handy in a few spots when firing arrows is faster or safer than using the sword. To get those 142 rupees, Lack needs this secret 100 bonus, and he gets 10 in this room in level 4. The remaining 32 have to come from killing enemies. This is why he forces a blue rupee drop instead of a bomb drop in level 4, and why he sometimes goes out of his way to grab rupees. Generally speaking, money isn't much of a problem in this run. There are other route variations with more financial responsibility, but not the route Lack is using right now.
Actually, I'm glad I got hit by the gorillas, because I probably would have gotten fairies, and then would have been SOL on Fidonga. Use that shield.
The entrance to level 5 is normally accessible through this path, and this map repeats itself until you go up 4 times. So it's much faster to go to the right of it and to use a screen scroll to reach it from there instead. Note that it's impossible to screen scroll through walls from left to right and through walls that are thicker than one tile on each screen. In both of those cases, Link would end up stuck in the wall instead. If that wall had been any thicker, Lack would have had to take the long way around. Here's the layout of level 5. This dungeon holds the recorder. The way the recorder works will be explained in a bit, but it's definitely going to be a very useful item from now on. It's all the way back in this corner, but it can be reached quickly with this underground shortcut that connects these two rooms. This room is an absolute nightmare though, and we'll talk about it more when we get there. After picking up the recorder, Lack will take this path to the boss.
Let's get this bread stick.
This is a Gibdo. Gibdos are slow but durable enemies, so the main challenge when fighting them is to deal a lot of damage as quickly as possible. Like Stalfos, some of them hold bombs or keys and will drop them when they die. This is a blue dark nut. As usual, blue dark nuts are stronger than their red counterparts, but otherwise functionally the same. They have double the HP, they deal double the damage, and they move faster. Blue dark nuts are some of the toughest enemies to kill, especially in large numbers or when running low on bombs. Luckily, Lack doesn't need to kill these ones since he can clip through the block instead, but next time, he won't be so lucky.
Come on!
And here's the room that, for obvious reasons, is called the Recorder Room. It's one of the most crucial points in the run due to having to defeat 6 blue dark nuts with only the wooden sword and bombs. They take 8 hits or 2 bombs to kill each, and they can kill Link in only 4 hits at this point, so it's difficult to survive and even harder to complete the room quickly. This is why a few minutes earlier, Lack said this.
After you get the recorder with 2 bombs, you can get excited.
Now's a good moment to talk about another important mechanic, the movement pattern of Zelda enemies. There are a few different movement patterns, but the most interesting enemies are aggressive. But what does that mean? It means that if they're lined up with their target, every so often they have a chance to turn directly towards it. They can also turn 90 degrees towards their target at any intersection based on a random timer as well, even if they're not directly aligned. In short, aggressive enemies will generally go towards their target. Now, the enemies can only have one target, Link, right? Of course not, that would be too simple. Enemies actually switch at random between 2 different targets, Link and the point directly opposite to Link's position. Link and his mirror image, called Anti-Link, are therefore the 2 different targets enemies can choose. The targets are switched at random every second or so, but this can be delayed during screen transitions. This is why even when entering a room on the same frame, enemies can still have 2 different patterns, one if they initially target Link, and one if they choose Anti-Link first. You can see this in action here. When Link is on one side of the room, sometimes Dark Nuts seem to be targeting the other side. Lack purposely positions himself near the middle of the room so that Link and Anti-Link are close to each other, which brings all the Dark Nuts together.
Okay.
The room went well overall. Sure, he could have done it faster, but by completing it in under 20 seconds with full health and 3 bombs, Lack could continue the run still ahead of the world record.
Get to 8. Lost all my time. Oh! That's okay. You get lucky. That was not lucky. Oh my god.
This room, however, did not go too well. Lack slashed the Gyarados slightly too early and hit it before it was aligned with the grid, which caused it to not get knocked back and allowed it to damage him. This set him up for a series of small time losses. First, he lost the ability to use the beam sword. This in turn forces him through a slower path in an incoming room, losing about half a second. Also, losing health means that he's gonna lose time on a refill at the end of the dungeon. To top it all off, he tried going back for the heart to mitigate the time loss, but missed it, only wasting more time. But wait, there's more! Taking damage also reset his bomb counter from 8 back to 0. He was trying to get a forced bomb drop from the Gyarados, but after taking damage and resetting his count, he had to resort to killing a Dodongo in the next room instead. Because Dodongos can also target Anti-Link, Lack was subject to a small chance that Dodongo would turn away from the bomb. Luckily, Dodongo ran into the bomb and Lack got his bomb drop, but that could have spelled disaster. In total, the mistake ended up costing him about 3 seconds, but it goes to show just how quickly the whole run can go south with just one tiny mistake.
That was really bad. Okay, we're fine. Really annoying.
This is Dig Dogger. It's invulnerable to Link's attacks until he plays the recorder, at which point it shrinks and starts moving faster. It needs 8 hits to kill, but remember that bombs do 4 damage. The strategy is pretty clever. Since Slack comes into the room with bombs equipped, he can put down a bomb, then switch to the recorder and make the boss vulnerable. The bomb timer keeps running during the recorder song, so it's a surefire, immediate hit when it ends. Instead of using a second bomb to finish it off, Lack uses the sword for the remaining hits. This is because he will need the recorder again just after leaving the dungeon. Switching between items on B takes a little over 2 seconds each time, so avoiding the item menu can be faster than using the best item at all times.
Beautiful. Alright, what can go wrong? Yeah, this run sucks.
Lack will be going to level 7 next. Now that he has the recorder, he can take a shortcut. Playing the recorder summons a whirlwind that warps Link to the entrance of a dungeon that he's already completed. It's possible to navigate between the dungeons by facing a direction when playing the recorder. The game keeps a list of every completed dungeon in ascending order and a pointer at the last position Link was sent to. Facing up or right moves the pointer to the following dungeon in the list, and facing down or left moves it back one spot. The pointer starts at level 1, so facing up or right brings Link to level 2, and facing down or left brings him to the highest level he's completed so far. In this case, the closest dungeon to his next destination is level 4. So, Lack plays the recorder twice while facing down, which brings the pointer to 5, then 4. Remember this, when he uses the recorder again later, the pointer will still be on 4.
Yeah, this run sucks.
Next, he needs to buy the meat and arrows from these two caves before making his way to level 7.
Well, insurance.
Here, Lack plays the recorder. It's not relevant to the secret stairs, and he doesn't actually want to warp here. But he does it for 3 reasons. First, it increments the warp destination back to level 5, which will be useful later. Second, for the same interaction with the bomb timer, but this time with the Armos. The Armos normally takes 1 second to wake up, so overlapping this timer with the recorder nullifies that wait. Finally, it also saves time when spawning the shopkeeper. In this screen, levers use a timer that gets set to different values based on their current cycle, the longest of which being just over 4 seconds when they're out and about. When Link enters the stairs, these timers do not get reinitialized, they just keep running until they expire. But the thing is, the shopkeeper appears in a puff of smoke, and this animation reuses the timer of the first lever. So, depending on where the lever is in its cycle, this can cause a time loss of up to 3.5 seconds at worst, but usually around a second or two. Playing the recorder gives time for the lever's long timer to expire, which in turn speeds up the shopkeeper's appearance. Because it saves time in 3 different ways, this is called the tricorder.
That's 7 arrows too.
Here's the layout of level 7. To reach the back half of the dungeon, Lack will need to get past this room by giving a hungry Gorilla the food that he just bought. The key item is the red candle, and it can be found here. It can be used to light up dark rooms, but that's optional in a speedrun setting. Its real use will be to burn a bush blocking the entrance to level 8. The red candle is an upgrade to the blue candle, but any of them can be used in this speedrun. There's another route that opts to get the blue candle from a merchant in the overworld and skip the red candle. Both routes have their advantages and their drawbacks, and neither of them comes out clearly on top. In general, the blue candle route is more money reliant and has a slightly different level order, which in turn makes the early parts of the run less forgiving. Money isn't a problem in the red candle route, but it can be harder in levels 5 and 7. After getting the candle, the only way to the boss is through this underground passage.
Well, that was my aqua bomb, but still out, still ahead.
Dig Dogger is back with a vengeance. This time, it's a mini boss and it splits into three instead of only getting smaller. So, Lack uses a second bomb to dispatch it efficiently. Here's Aquamentus again. This time, however, it's much, much stronger. Oops, turns out it wasn't any stronger. It's the same easy fight as level 1.
Alright, good 7.
Next up is level 6, but before that, Lack will pick up a much needed attack upgrade, the Magical Sword. To wield it though, he needs to have 12 hearts and he only has 10. So he picks up two bonus heart containers in the overworld, here and here. But wait, he's all the way on the other side of the map. Well, that's not a problem for Lack. This is called a world wrap. The screen scroll glitch allows Link to get out of the map's boundaries, at which point Link wraps around to the other side. The overworld screens are ordered from left to right, top to bottom in memory. Going to the left of this screen simply brings Link to the end of the previous row, so he goes one screen up and 15 to the right. Here, Lack is crossing the water like it's nothing. Normally, the ladder only lets Link cross a single tile of water. But water tiles behave essentially the same as normal walls. So positioning Link at the right spot and pressing perpendicular for a frame lets him bypass the collision from touching water, which allows him to cross more tiles. Remember that because Link came from a screen scroll, he doesn't collide with the first water block. After picking up these two heart containers, Lack finally has 12 hearts and he can go to the magical sword all the way back on the other side of the map. What just happened here? This is the Rook Order, named after its discoverer, Rooslugs. It looks fancy, but it's actually pretty simple. Lack used a block clip to step onto the water, then played the recorder while facing up. Because the pointer was moved to level 5 earlier, and because level 6 hasn't been beaten yet, the pointer is moved to level 7, which is here. Now the Whirlwind has a specific mechanic. When it takes Link to his destination, it actually moves him horizontally and triggers a screen scroll to the right. To make it so the next screen is the correct destination, it sets Link's position to be whatever screen is to the left of that destination just before the screen scrolls. Meanwhile, because Link was to the left of the dock, the Whirlwind moved him to that square, activating the raft which takes Link up. So the Whirlwind moves Link to the right and the raft moves him up, both at the same time. As a result, Link moves diagonally upright, and he ends up reaching the edge of the screen facing up. The scroll direction is based on Link's facing angle, so the screen is scrolled up instead of right. Remember that the recorder sets Link's current screen to be one screen to the left of his destination. But because he goes up instead of right, he ends up one screen diagonally up left off of his intended destination. Since that destination was level 7, he ends up in the graveyard instead, right next to the magical sword cave.
Got the sword.
Now, Lack is right next to level 6, so he can just walk there. Here's the layout of level 6. This dungeon contains the magical rod, a powerful weapon that fires waves of magic and that is completely optional, so it will be skipped. The way to the boss is pretty straightforward, only requiring to clear a few rooms and reveal a secret staircase. These are whiz robes. The red and blue ones differ a bit more than most enemies, so let's talk about them separately. Red whiz robes appear, attack Link with a spell, and vanish to reappear somewhere else. This makes them quite tricky to chase down and kill when necessary. On top of that, their spells deal 4 full hearts of damage, so they can be extremely deadly. Instead of appearing periodically, blue whiz robes walk around, phasing through obstacles, and occasionally phase diagonally as well. They also attack Link on sight with spells. Although blue whiz robes have 2.5 times the health and twice the contact damage as their red counterparts, their spells only deal half the damage at 2 hearts each. Their durability makes them especially difficult to defeat quickly. Lack waited in the doorway for a fraction of a second. The whiz robes were trying to spawn a line to Link either horizontally or vertically. By staying in the doorway, the vertical alignment is unavailable, forcing them to all line up in front of Link. This is a Like-Like. They are very durable, worm-like creatures that suck Link in if they touch him, damaging him in the process.
Ooh, I like that. Thank you. That's nice.
That was Goma. It can be one shot with an arrow.
Alright, let's go.
Now, Lack placed the recorder twice while facing up, so the counter goes back to level 1, then level 2. From here, level 8 is very close. To enter it, he needs the red candle that he got from level 7 to burn a tree and reveal the staircase. Here's the layout of level 8. This dungeon has two key items. The first one is the Book of Magic, which improves the Magical Rod spell. Needless to say, that's not going to be very useful. The second one is literally a key item. The Magical Key is a dungeon key with unlimited uses. However, with clever route planning, Lack already collects the exact amount of keys that he needs to beat the game, and the detour needed to get the Magical Key simply isn't worth the two keys it would save. On the way to the boss, these two rooms are very challenging. The first one contains 5 blue darknuts and 4 fire-breathing statues, and the second one contains 6 blue darknuts and 2 fire-breathing statues. Clearing both rooms quickly is one of the most challenging parts of the run. After that, this underground passage leads to the boss and the Triforce piece. It's worth noting that considering how difficult these rooms are and how easily one can lose 10 seconds or even more in each one of them, this was a rather amazing outcome.
Yeah, that was a bomb.
This is Gleok from level 4, back with 4 heads instead of 2 this time. Aside from that, the fight is functionally the same.
Alright, here we go.
It's time for level 9, which is here. To get to it faster, Lack uses the recorder while facing down to go to level 1 and simply walks and screen scrolls his way to the final dungeon in the game. The final level has the most daunting layout. It's full of the most powerful enemies and riddled with secret passages linking otherwise isolated parts of the dungeon. It's a nerve-wracking gauntlet that can end the run at the slightest mistake. There are two key items here. The first one is the Red Ring, which cuts all incoming damage to 1/4, effectively quadrupling Link's health. As useful as that is though, it's not required, and Lack Attack beats the game without any defense upgrades. The other key item is the only one that can deal the final blow to Ganon, the silver arrow found in this corner. To reach it, Lack will need to go through this tunnel, then go to this secret room behind a bombable wall which holds a secret tunnel that leads to another tunnel to a room with another secret staircase. Once the silver arrow is acquired, it's go mode. A secret staircase leads to these upper two rooms, and one final tunnel brings Link to a mini-boss encounter, and finally, to Ganon.
Got a clock coming.
This is Patra. For now, this enemy can be bypassed. With a combination of perfect positioning and a well-timed sword slash, Lack is able to leave the room without a fight. The final Patra will have to be defeated to open the door to Ganon.
Come on, clock. Come on, clock. Oh, that was the last one, dang. It's fine. Seven o'clock. Not looking, I have no idea. Alright, would like a heart.
Here, Lack needs one heart because when fighting the final Patra, having seven hearts allows him to be able to survive three hits instead of only two.
There it was.
This is Patra again. This one has to be defeated to open the door to Ganon. It can almost exclusively be damaged with the sword. On top of that, the core is invulnerable until every orbiting eye is killed. The outer eyes will spin in two different patterns at random, so recognizing which pattern they're doing is key to clearing them as fast as possible.
Alright, this is it.
Finally, this is Ganon. He goes invisible and shoots fireballs at Link, but he always moves 4 blocks, turning back if he hits a wall, then turn 90 degrees towards Link. This typically results in Ganon moving along one of these two squares. Once he's hit, he teleports to one of two positions, either here or here. The location is random, but it can be predicted. When invisible, Ganon actually cycles through 6 different poses on every frame. This cycle stops when he's hit, so he shows one single pose while he's stunned for exactly 63 frames. Also, Ganon's next location depends on the parity of the global timer. to the right on odd frames and to the left on even frames. Using this information, it's possible to deduce where Ganon will be after hitting him. Since the pose cycle and the stun duration are both fixed, the cycle can be divided into set A and set B. In any given fight, each of these sets will always go to each side of the room. Runners can use the first hit to find out which set goes to which side and predict Ganon's next location for the rest of the fight. This strategy is great on paper, but in reality, it's extremely difficult to process all of this information in a fraction of a second. Also, going to the right side involves the risk of running into Ganon, which, remember, deals 4 hearts of contact damage. So, runners typically focus on survival and aim for the left side every time. If that misses, they have to wait for Ganon to move to the center to hit him again. Also, if the sword slash is timed right and Ganon is hit on the first possible frame, he will stay on the same side and essentially be stun-locked. Basically, it boils down to this: after the initial hit, Lack flips a coin. If he wins the coin toss, he gets to stun-lock Ganon. If he doesn't, he loses 2 seconds and flips the coin again. With the magical sword, Ganon takes 4 hits. Let's see how that went. As you can see, Lack was quite unlucky and he guessed wrong all 3 times. Fortunately, he was far enough ahead to still achieve the first ever 27.
Yeah! Crap, oh my god, 25. I was 16 seconds ahead. I can't even believe I lost so much time at the end, but it doesn't matter. I did it. 27.
Usually in these videos, this is when I go through the possible improvements of the run, but this one's a bit different. The Legend of Zelda is a very unique speedrun. Even at the top level, there isn't one clear-cut strategy to execute perfectly. A large portion of the run is coming up with the fastest way to clear all the enemies, reacting to their random patterns on the spot and using your limited toolset to its fullest extent, all while juggling with internal counters and pulling off pixel-perfect tricks dozens of times. There is no understating just how incredibly skillful this world record is, and yet there's so much room left for improvement. This minute break was an absolutely amazing achievement, but as crazy as it sounds, it might not even be the last one.